The word of God is powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the dividing of asunder. It reaches the bone marrow, it judges the thoughts and the intents of the heart. I am waiting for others right now. I am waiting for others right now to log into our live program tonight. Tonight. Remember, I said I want you to create an environment for a miracle. I want you to create an environment for prayer tonight. It's going to be something good. I want you to pray with me. If you are not feeling well, if there are things that are happening in your life, I know we have so many challenges in this life, but I want to assure you tonight that He is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think that works in us. I'm inviting you right now. I'm inviting you, please invite others. Please invite others if you can, so that we may be together tonight. Please do me a favor. I want you to create an environment for a minute, to create an environment for prayer, because that I'm going to minister to you tonight. So I'm inviting you. I am welcoming you to this program. God is going to meet you at the point of your need. Something tremendous in the shed of this tree. While water is brought to wash your feet. And since you have honored your servant with this visit, let me prepare food to refresh you before you continue on your journey. All right, they said, do as you have said. I want us to jump to verse number 10. Then one of them said, I will return to you about this time next year, and your wife Sarah will have a son. Sarah was listening to this conversation from the tent. Abraham and Sarah were both very old by this time, and Sarah was long past the age of having children. So she laughed silently to herself and said, how could a worn-out woman like me enjoy such a pleasure, especially when my master, my husband, is also so old? Then the Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh? Why did she say, can an old woman like me have a baby? Is there anything too hard for the Lord? I will return about this time next year, and Sarah will have a son. Sarah was afraid, so she denied it, saying, I didn't laugh. But the Lord said, no, you did laugh. May God bless the reading of His word tonight. I'm going to share with you on a subject I have entitled, is there anything too hard for the Lord? Is there anything too hard for the Lord? If you are with me tonight, I want you to type, is there anything too hard for the Lord? I want you to share with the people who are seated or standing next to you and just tell them, is there anything too hard for the Lord? I believe that something tremendous is going to happen tonight, and I want you to connect with me tonight. Let us connect in the spirit, and God is going to minister to you in a special way. Ladies and gentlemen, the story begins with a special visitation. The story begins with a unique and a divine visitation. And Abraham had no clue of what was about to happen in his life. He had no idea of what was about to take place in his life. And I want you to understand that the Bible says that Abraham was sitting in his tent in the heat of the day. And it was during, I want to believe that it was in the afternoon. And he saw three men who were standing nearby him. And I want you to understand, according to Genesis chapter number 13, verse 18, that when Abraham moved his camp to Hebron, he also built an altar at the same place that God visited him. Check this out. Abraham built an altar at the same place that God visited him. These three men visited Abraham at the same place, or in the same environment, he built an altar. In other words, an altar is a place of meeting. He created an airport for the Lord to meet him. He created a place of exchange where the divine and the natural meet, and there is an exchange that will take place. Ladies and gentlemen, an altar is a portal for open heavens. And tonight I believe that you can create your own altar of prayer, a place of meeting, and your own altar of worship, your altar of giving. You can create your own altar tonight and allow God to visit or to minister in your life in a special way. Ladies and gentlemen, I believe that there is a special visitation that is coming into your life. There is a special visitation that is coming your way right now in the name of Jesus. A visitation that is going to transform your life. A visitation that is going to change your spiritual life, your spiritual understanding. An elevation is about to take place. An encounter that is going to change everything about you, the total being, the tripartite being. An encounter that is going to change your physical life. An encounter that is going to change your emotional life. An encounter that is going to change your spiritual life. I also want you to check this out. The Bible says the Lord appeared, and the word appear in Hebrew is the word Ra. Ra means the Lord visibly appeared to Abraham. Ladies and gentlemen, this was not just but an ordinary visitation, but rather it was a supernatural and a special visitation. It is indeed my prayer that the Lord will do something new in your life. There is an encounter that will change your life forever. It reminds me in the book of Acts chapter number 9 that the apostle Paul had a wonderful, a remarkable visitation which changed his life, which saw his life being changed from being a murderer but to be a saver of life. Ladies and gentlemen, I believe that the greatest encounter that you need in your life today is the encounter with Jesus. When you encounter him, your life will never be the same again. The Bible says in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter number 5:17, if therefore you be in Christ Jesus, you are now a new person. Former things have passed, and behold, all things have become new. I want to encourage you today not to live with a guilty conscience, because when you be in Christ, you are now a new creation, a new person, and your life has become new. All things have passed away. I want you to know that there is something that God is about to do in our lives. And the Bible says, as Abraham saw the men, three individuals, the writer presents the three men as three men. And the Bible says, as Abraham lifted up his eyes to see her. You know, I liked the word that Abraham lifted up his eyes to see, and he looked and he saw. Now, if you read your Bible very well, in the book of Genesis chapter number 13, Abraham and Lot, when they were about to separate, Abraham said to Lot, we don't have to have strife between us, because we are but brethren. But separate yourself from me. Now you choose first. And the Bible says that Lot lifted up his eyes. Lot lifted up his eyes. I want you to know that there is something that God is about to do in your life. Check this out. Lot lifted up his eyes. After lifting up his eyes, and the Bible says he chose a place, the plain of Jordan, which was towards Sodom and Gomorrah. And the Bible says that the people of Sodom and Gomorrah were so wicked. They were so wicked. He lifted up his own eyes. But if you go to a verses down below, you will notice that after Lot had separated himself from Abraham, the Bible says, and the Lord said Abraham, now lift up your eyes. That means the lifting up of Lot's eyes was an ordinary lifting up of his eyes. But as for Abraham, it was a divine instruction from the Lord. Oh, something tremendous is about to happen. You need to allow the Lord to teach you to lift up your eyes, to open up your eyes. You need the Lord to train you, to teach you to lift up the eyes. Usasimudze maziso uri wega, ukaona uri wega une zvimwe zvinhu zvausingagone kuona. But you need the Lord to teach you how to open your eyes. Ah, I'm feeling it. It's gonna be good in here. You need the Lord to teach you how to lift up your eyes. And then if you check the word, he lifted up his eyes, it speaks about an instruction to perceive, to go beyond ordinary seeing. He lifted up his eyes. Ladies and gentlemen, pane zvimwe zvinhu zvausingagone kuona kana uine vamwe vanhu in your life. There is need of a separation for you to be able to see certain things in your life. Check this out. There are two things that happened there. Number one, separation. Number two, the lifting up of Abraham's eyes. I'm loving this. It's gonna be good in a moment. Number one, there is need for separation. Separation sometimes is very important. You might as well need to separate from other people. Separate yourself from other people. It reminds me in Matthew chapter number 14 that Jesus had to separate his disciples from the crowds. If God is about to take you to another place, there is need of separation. There is need of separation. Separate yourself from bad influence. Separate yourself from evil tendencies. Separate yourself from wrong attitudes. Separate yourself, brother, and you will be able to see what you have never seen in your life. And the Bible says that Abraham lifted up his eyes, and the lifting up of Abraham's eyes would also entail the lifting up of his spiritual faculties, so that they may be able to interact with the divine, so that they may be able to understand the things of the Spirit. The Bible says that we do not walk by sight, but rather we walk by faith. I'm about to preach and we close this thing. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to understand certain things. Abraham began to see in a different manner. And the Bible says Abraham went to this man and he bowed down to the ground. The aspect of bowing down, or the posture of bowing down to the ground, depicts that he was a humble man, and it might also mean that he worshipped them in a way. And I want you to understand, ladies and gentlemen, if God is about to do something new, be prepared to be a worshiper, because worship attracts the presence of God. Worship attracts the divine. Worship attracts the Trinity. Worship attracts the God in us. I'm about to preach and we close. And the Bible says Abraham, oh my God, bowed down before the Lord. And as he bowed down, he said to them, "My Lord, if I have found favor in thy sight." I like the word "found favor." It means if I've been detected by the Spirit, if I've been discovered by the Spirit, if I've been recognized by the Spirit, if I've been gained by the Spirit, let you sit down as I fetch for some water and rest yourselves under the tree. Check this out. The Bible says he offered them a meal. Not just a meal. He offered them a shed. So Abraham, number one, he prepared a meal. In other words, he prepared a table. He created an environment conducive for a miracle to happen in his life. He created a comfortable place for the Lord. He created a room for a miracle. Abraham was hospitable. He was there and he wanted the men to relax and to rest.
under a shed. Oh, check this out. The God's visitation on earth came to do just but two issues. Number one, God came also as a result that he wanted to deal with Sodom and Gomorrah. In actual fact, he wanted to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. But at the same time, he also wanted to address Abraham's issues. I'm about to preach and we close. The sins of the wicked people of Sodom and Gomorrah attracted God for destruction, but the faith of Abraham attracted God for a miracle. Your faith will attract God for a miracle. Ladies and gentlemen, it is high time as the church that our faith will attract God to destroy our coronavirus. Our faith is about to attract the attention of heaven to destroy this outbreak. I feel that heaven is about to kiss the earth. I feel that the heavens is about to superimpose itself on the earth. The devil is a liar. He is a qualified failure. I want you to understand one thing. He prepared a shed. He arranged a shed, but the shed was on a tree, and it meant fellowship was going to take place under the tree. Oh, I love this. Do you know that without the cross, there is no fellowship? Abraham was creating a room for fellowship. Ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you something. They sat under the tree and they began to enjoy the meal. I liked the way Abraham did it. As the men were relaxing, he went to his wife and he said to Sarah, quickly prepare some cakes. He went to a young man and he said, please prepare the goat. Let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, it's high time when you want God to do something in your life. Hurry up and do the best that you can. I always say, kana uchida kuona mwari vachikuitira zvausati vambokuitira, imbovaitirawo zvausati wambovaitira. It's coming up and I'm feeling it in the name of Jesus. Not only that, did he prepare a meal, he also washed their feet. According to manners and customs of the Oriental lands, the washing of feet in the Jewish culture was a sign of welcoming the guest. It reminds me in Luke chapter number 7, verse 44, Jesus said to Simon, look at this woman kneeling here. When I entered your home, you didn't offer me water to wash the dust from my feet, but she has washed them with your tears and wiped them with your hair. Ladies and gentlemen, learn to accommodate Christ in your life. Accommodate his presence in your life. Accommodate his divinity in your life. He made ready the meal and he stood by them, watching them while they enjoyed the meal. Abraham was not eating together with them, but rather he was just standing. Challenge yatina yovatende. Nekuti when we get into a time of worship, we also begin to ask. When we get into a time of worship, worship and worship and worship. Don't ask anything. Usadye pamwe chete namwari. Kana mwari varivo vari kudya worship, regera vadye iwe wakatarisa. Wait until he's done with eating. I know him. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is able to meet you at the point of your need. I want you to understand, as they were eating, if you read your Bible very well, it says, and they said, where is Sarah, your wife? Check this out. They said, maybe the two of them or the three of them, they said, where is Sarah, your wife? life. Remember, Abraham anoitonganga pressure. Pansoro pekuti anenemana. Because remember kuti Ishmael anga apo. But munhu airamba aine shungu yekuti ndiri kuda mwana ndi Sera. But Sera anga asipo pashanywa nevarume vatatu. Let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, murume wa Hana ana pressure yevana. Ndakune mumwe mukadzi anonzi Penina. Kune vana vari ikoko. Ane pressure ndi Hana. Ane Sara, kureva kuti ane pressure ngaregere kushayikwa panzvimbo yaanofanira kuonekwa. I'm about to preach and we close. Sei uchishayikwa pa prayer panguva yaunofanira kuonekwa. Sei uchishayikwa pa fasting panguva yaunofanira kuonekwa. Sei uchishayikwa pa worship panguva yaunofanira kuonekwa. Where is Sarah, your wife? Your challenge ndeyekuti paunofanirwa kunge uripo. It reminds me in John chapter 20, verse number 24. The Bible says, Thomas the Didymus was not there when Jesus appeared. Ladies and gentlemen, usajaire kushayikwa pa unofanirwa kunge uri. Usajaire kushayikwa pa fellowship pa time ya unofanira kunge uripo. God is about to do something. And the Bible says, pavari kubvunza kuti, where is your Sarah? And they said, and they asked, where is Sarah, your wife? Bible kareverenga not, and Abraham said, behold, she is in the tent. Chinzwa Bible not. And he said, I will certainly come back to her according to the time of life. I love this word. Pavakabvunza presence ya Sarah, vakabvunza vese kuti where, and they said, where is Sarah? But paanotaura nyaya yekubata mwana, unonzwa Bible not, and I will. Nda zvitwa nevatumwa, zvinoitwa naJehovah. Let me prophesy to you right now. It's not about the people that are around you, but it's about the Lord. I said it's about the Lord. It is for his name's sake that is going to perform a miracle. It is for his name's sake that is going to do great things in your life. I'm feeling the spirit of a prayer warrior coming out of me now in the mighty name of Jesus. Get ready to pray with me right now. Create an environment for a miracle, because something tremendous is about to happen. I will come back to you according to the time of life, and Sarah, your wife, shall have a son. Let me tell you, people of God, and when Sarah had this in the tent, the Bible said she laughed in her, and the Lord picked it up, and the Lord asked Abraham, why did your wife laugh? Yes, she laughed. Maybe because she was sick and tired of empty promises. She was sick and tired of praying for a child and nothing was happening. But let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, she was hopeless. She was sick and tired of empty encouragement. She was sick and tired of promises. Maybe that's the reason why she laughed. And the Lord said, is there anything too hard for the Lord? Let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, there is a special visitation that is coming your way. I know you've got a situation. I know you've been promised. I know you've been encouraged for too long. But is there anything too hard for the Lord? You've been praying for a job. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? You've been praying for a child. Is there anything? There is a God in heaven who is a miracle worker, way maker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. He is able to perform a miracle in your life, in your family, in your business, in your career. He is able. I have known him. He is able. I wonder if you know him. He did it to Jacob that day. He did it to Joseph that day. He did it to Hannah that day. He can still do it for you today. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? I pray for you tonight. God is releasing a miracle right now, wherever you are, in the name of Jesus. Arthritis has no portion in your life. Tuberculosis has no portion in your life. HIV and AIDS, in the name of Jesus. Every chronic illness, at the sound of my voice, I command you right now to be finished by the power of the Holy Ghost, by the supernatural ability, in the name of the Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? Right now, as I'm speaking to you, I feel the power and the move of the Spirit hitting me right now, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I release the power of the Lord in your life. I release the supernatural ability to do things you couldn't able to do. In the name of Jesus, every weapon fashioned against you in judgment, it shall be condemned. In the name of Jesus, rise up, child of God. Begin to pray with me right now. The devil is a loser. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? I'm feeling it right now. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? Coronavirus, you are too little in the hands of my Lord. Coronavirus, wherever you are, in the mighty name of Jesus, is there anything too hard for the Lord? Akaribadosa kalababayanda kebebesha liete demela kanaba mama 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 la dodoko boroko soto nolibiaka ibradoko zuzu mande mekabalaga. Pray with me right now. Distance is not a barrier. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? I want you to believe right now. I want you to raise your standard of faith. I want you to believe that there is only one God between men and him. His name is the man Jesus, one mediator, in the name of Jesus. I'm feeling it right now, because the Bible says he who dwells under the secret place of the Most High God shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Thou shalt never be afraid of a terror by night, nor an arrow that flieth by the day. I say, is there anything too hard for the Lord? In the name of Jesus, there is no situation that is too hard for the Lord. There is no challenge that is too hard for the Lord. There is no predicament that is too hard for the Lord. There is no situation that is too hard for my God. He is a powerful God. The one I am who I am. He is right here with you, in the name of Jesus. I repeat it to you. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? Nditerere Abraham wakasekwa nenyika zvikakwana. Check this out. Pane munana miviri yakuitika pano. Abraham was too old, and Sarah had reached menopause. But the Lord said, I will come back to you according to the time of life. In other words, I will revitalize, I will energize Abraham again, because the name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the joy of the Lord is my strength. Check this out, brother. Vaya vakanzi vapera simba, akatanga kupiwa simba zvekare. And as for Sarah, chibereko chakanga chafa, chakawana life again, in the name of Jesus. I speak life to your marriage. I speak life to your business. I speak life to your ministry. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? Arabado shakalaba, ibrado kobobobo yanda, eblakianda shakalekede. The devil is a loser. Right now, in the name of Jesus, I feel the Spirit of God in Jesus' mighty name. Uri bandu renyasha shangala. Also, mtamba nae Abraham anote. If I have found favor in your sight, uri bandu renyasha. You are a bundle of grace. Hapana chinokubata, hapana anokuuraya, hapana anokudzikisira. In the name of Jesus, is there too hard for the Lord? Pray with me right now. As I break, as I bind, as I renounce and denounce, I thwart, I annihilate, I destroy every arsenal of the devil against your life. In the name of Jesus, every weapon of the devil is under my feet, under subjection to the obedience of Christ. Jesus, you are rising above your challenges. You are rising above your limitations. Pray with me now. The Spirit of the Lord is upon you right now. In the name of Jesus, we cancel every contract with the devil. Ndinokuramba nisaizvezvi nemubatanidzwa wevarombe. Ndinokuramba nisaizvezvi nemubatanidzwa wechirwere. Ndinokuramba nisaizvezvi nemubatanidzwa weurombo. In the name of Jesus, I fight witchcraft in your life. Is there anything too hard? Listen to me, Harare. Listen to me, Zimbabwe. Listen to me, Bulawayo. Listen to me, South Africa. Listen to me, Zambia. Is there anything, Africa? Is there anything too hard for the Lord? If the Lord be with us, who can be against us? In the name of Jesus, right now, you ain't gonna die. You ain't gonna faint, because the Bible says, them that wait upon the Lord shall be renewed their strength. And the Lord renewed the strength of Abraham in the mighty name of Jesus. Abalo Sokoto, Rebakita Balaga, Emaraka Dube, Aleka Dusha Mahande, Jacqua Badiaka De, Aloto Komondosha, Ileke De Beada. In the name of Jesus, you are not sick, but you are healed. You are not poor, but you are rich. Is there anything too hard? I said too hard. I said too hard for the Lord. In the name of Jesus, if you believe it, I want you to type, I am a bundle of grace. I am a child of God, blood washed.